Back as a woman, I'd want to come back as Loretta Lynn. What great songs that she's written.
With her simple, poetic voice of the people, she brought a fresh honesty to her music.
Loretta just is a fiery, feisty little thing that writes really genius country songs.
She transformed the role of token girl singer into a powerful voice for women.
Since I've got the pill.
In a time where women had no voice, she would speak up.
She had the guts to talk about things that were kind of taboo at the time.
But the years in between were a constant fight for everything she believed in. She stood her ground in a tempestuous, often abusive marriage.
It was one of those very, very volatile relationships where she would give as good as she got.
Dude never smacked me one time, but he didn't get two smacks back.
She agonized over the balance between family and career.
She said, this is not my house. I don't live here.
I'm a stranger in my own home.
If I'd known what was going to happen, I wouldn't have started singing.
But she gave it up to spend a few precious moments with her friend and partner before he quietly slipped away.
Finally, I looked down at him and said, honey, you just go around the corner and I'll be okay.
The remarkable life and celebrated career of Loretta Lynn, the coal miner's daughter, on CMT Inside Fame.
This year, the Country Music Hall of Fame honors one of the most admired women of our time. She was born a coal miner's daughter, but she has become a country music legend, Miss Loretta Lynn.
Loretta Lynn's 1988 induction into the Hall of Fame was but one of many honors that have been bestowed upon her. But her extraordinary life and strength in the face of adversity are as important to her legend as her award-winning music and career.
She's a strong woman, had a lot of heartache, but then there's still so much sparkle and love in her heart for her fans.
Unashamedly Kentucky, unabashedly country, unapologetically feminist, and a great honky-tonk singer.
Loretta Lynn has achieved more than simple stardom. She has transcended into icon status, known by millions around the world as a woman who speaks with simple dignity and honesty in both her career and in her life.
She's just the coal miner's daughter, but she's like so real that she opens that mouth to talk. You know exactly what's on her mind, and you know that it's coming from a real place, and you can trust it.
You never know what she's going to say. Whatever comes to mind comes out, and I love that about her.
Get your eyes on me. You're looking at country.
Loretta Webb was born on April 14, 1935, in a depressed region of Johnson County, Kentucky, known as Butcher Holler. She was the second of eight children born to Ted Webb, a coal miner, and his wife Clara. The abject poverty of her Eastern Kentucky childhood would become the cornerstone of both her art and her famous openness and approachability.
You know, back then, for people to live in a one-room house, we didn't really know how poor we was. You really don't know it till you go to bed hungry. And, you know, then that you don't have something to eat.
We're talking, you know, no running water, no electricity, no toilet. You know, the whole mountain poverty works.
I think one of the things that Loretta's having grown up so poor did for her, she simply didn't understand a lack of possibilities, because growing up in Butcher Holler, she wasn't sure what possibility meant even.
Even though Loretta may not have known what possibility meant, at age 13, she encountered a major possibility in the person of Oliver Vannetta Lynn, known to the residents of Butcher Holler as Mooney or Doolittle. He had just returned from a stint in the Army and showed up at a bakery auction that was intended to raise money for the school Loretta attended.
That night he bought my pie, and whoever bought your pie, they had to walk you home, you know. So, Dude wanted me to get in that Jeep. I looked at that Jeep, and God, I wouldn't have crawled in that thing for nothing. It looked like it was something from outer space, you know. And he said, why won't you ride? I said, I'm not getting in that thing. So we went out of the holler carrying pine torches.
The schoolgirl was immediately taken with the brash young man and the twinkle in his eye. But Doolittle Lynn had a reputation for drinking and womanizing, and Loretta's parents made their feelings clear.
But I just figured Mommy and Daddy would kill me. There wasn't much said about it, except you're never to see that boy again. He's too old and he's too wild.
4 months later, in January 1949, Loretta went completely against her parents' wishes and married Doolittle Lynn. He was 21, she was 13. Loretta had no idea what was in store.
She was a child. He was more than a husband. He raised her.
My mother, you know, she knew Mooney, and she knew Mooney probably more than Loretta did when she married Mooney. She didn't sign the papers. She didn't go to the wedding. She didn't want her daughter marrying young.
I didn't even know what marrying was. I found out.
Loretta's marriage did not get off to a fairy tale start. Unlike her dear father, Doolittle Lynn was not a gentle, understanding man.
My daddy never did accept Doo very well. And the first two things that he promised Daddy was, don't ever lay a hand on me, and don't ever take me away where he couldn't see me.
Both promises to Loretta's father were soon broken. The first was broken within 24 hours of the wedding, when playing a game she often played with her siblings, Loretta made an innocent rhyme using the word whore. She'd heard the word used by the older schoolboys, but had no idea what it meant.
He left the door open. So I said, shut the door, you little... Just rhyming a line. I didn't know what that meant. So he come back and just put me over his lap, and he busted my butt. Now that's the next day. He already messed up with Daddy right there.
I think most young girls, for better or worse, believe men are like their fathers. If they come from a gentle father like a Ted Webb, they assume that all men are going to be that way. And it was a great shock.
Within 5 months, Doolittle had taken up with another woman. He sent the 14-year-old Loretta home to her parents. She was confused and humiliated, and she was 4 months pregnant. But before the baby was born, a repentant Doolittle returned for Loretta.
Daddy really got tore up about it. They didn't know I was going to go back to him.
Loretta's father was in for another blow as Doolittle Lynn broke his second promise. Soon after Loretta returned to him, Doolittle and Loretta's brother, Jay Lee, hitchhiked to Washington, where they found work as farmhands. Weeks later, Loretta, now 7 months pregnant, followed Doolittle across the country to the Pacific Northwest.
I think Loretta hoped that when they got to Washington, they would have a marriage like her parents, maybe, or a normal marriage. And then when she realized very quickly that Doo wasn't always going to be home, she fell back into what must have been a very innate, natural survival.
Loretta was 14 when her first child was born. By the time she was 18, she had four children, Betty Sue, Jack Benny, Ernest Ray, and Clara Marie, nicknamed Sissy. But Doolittle's drinking and philandering didn't stop. He would frequently leave for days, even weeks at a time, leaving a destitute Loretta to fend alone for herself and her children.
We dandelions, me and the kids, for almost 2 weeks. It was day to day that I just think, well, he'll come in tomorrow. He'll be home tomorrow.
She was able to shoot game for the kids to eat, pick greens for the kids to eat, and basically make it on her own from time to time when he did leave town.
There's been three or four times I would have left him, because I had a reason to. But how can you go 3,000 miles with four kids and no money?
One of them is toddling and one is a crawling and two's on the way.
Coming up on CMT Inside Fame, Loretta's dreams come true.
Bonnie, my sister-in-law, come on the phone. And she said, Loretta, are you sitting down? And I said, yeah.
And later, Loretta deals with an unfaithful husband in her own special way.
That's the way that I got him back. Was right about it and sang to him. There, how you like that? You know?
When CMT Inside Fame continues. In 1953, 18-year-old Loretta Lynn was living anything but the life of a woman of leisure. She was the mother of four with a philandering husband 8 years her senior. To make matters worse, the couple was living in Washington State, far, far away from Loretta's family. Though she was surrounded by a family of her own, Loretta Lynn was, in many ways, all alone.
It was day to day that I just think, well, he'll come in tomorrow. He'll be home tomorrow. This went on, you know, for 2 weeks.
When Doolittle finally did return home, there was hell to pay. The relationship remained as volatile as ever, with Doolittle frequently using his hands to get his point across. But young Loretta gave as good as she got.
Doo never smacked me one time, and he didn't get two smacks back. I grew up tough. And I told Doo one day, I wrote a song about it. I'm made out of tough stuff. But he didn't beat up on me without me hitting him back.
Loretta's lot in life continued in the same vein for several years. She fended for herself and her children the best she could without the help of her family. She missed her life in Butcher Holler, especially her father. In 1959, at age 23, Loretta was awakened by a disturbing dream. It left her with the unshakable fear that the separation from her father was about to become permanent.
I woke up crying, and Deuce said, "What's wrong?" I said, "My daddy's dead." He said, "Oh, no." I said, "Yes, I had a dream about it, Deuce." Finally went back to sleep and woke back up. It just added on to my dream. It just was more stuff, like the coffin was sitting at the old well box in Butcher Holler and propped up on little tiny rocks, I thought. And I thought I was going around the coffin and wringing my hands and crying.
Early the following morning, Loretta was awakened by a knock on the door. Her landlord told her she had a telephone call from back home.
And Bonnie, my sister-in-law, come on the phone. And she said, "Loretta, are you sitting down?" I said, "Yeah." She said, "Your daddy just died." So when daddy had his stroke was when I was dreaming.
The year following her father's death was a seminal year for Loretta. She channeled her grief into singing and even taught herself to play a cheap guitar Doolittle had bought for her a few years earlier. She learned several Kitty Wells songs, and she would often play and sing around the house, but only for Doolittle and the children. Then, in early 1960, when Loretta was 24, Doolittle announced that Loretta was ready to play in public. For reasons Loretta could not understand, Doolittle was confident she could make a career out of singing.
Then he came in one night and he said, "Well, you're about ready now. I'm going to get you a job." And says, "You can work for 2 years and we'll buy us a house and it'll be over."
The great love between Loretta and Doo was the fact that he believed so fiercely in her. He might call her a dumb hillbilly or make fun of her on some levels. But if there was ever a person who absolutely believed in Loretta and made her feel completely special, it was Doolittle Lynn.
Doolittle arranged a spur-of-the-moment audition for Loretta with a local band called the Westerners. The painfully shy country girl was terrified to get on stage, but Doolittle insisted. The band liked what they heard and invited Loretta to sing with them at a dance hall in Blaine, Washington.
$5 on a Saturday night, and I saved my money up, bought me a felt hat, and a skirt with fringe on it, it's culottes. And a black shirt with red, big red roses, and white Acme boots. Man, Annie Oakley couldn't have held a candle for me.
Loretta's confidence grew with every performance. In just a few months, she had her own band called Loretta's Trailblazers, with her brother J. Lee Webb on lead guitar, Roland Smiley on pedal steel, and Loretta on rhythm guitar and vocal. They had been playing for several months at a local tavern when Doolittle entered Loretta in an amateur contest on a regional TV show out of Tacoma, Washington. It was hosted by a young country singer named Buck Owens.
Doo took me down to his TV show and asked Buck if I couldn't sing, and I sang Whispering Sea. That was the third song I'd wrote. And this man from Vancouver, Canada, he owned a big lumber yard. He seen me sing Whispering Sea. So he called for me to come up to talk to him. Mr. Burley was his name.
Norm Burley's business was lumber, not music. But his wife had recently died, and Loretta's song Whispering Sea had touched him. The wealthy Vancouver businessman not only paid for a recording session, but even created a record label just for Loretta. They called it Zero Records. In 1960, she and Doolittle drove to Los Angeles and recorded two of the songs she had written, Whispering Sea and I'm a Honky Tonk Girl.
And now I'm a honky tonk girl.
In the late spring of 1960, with a little of Norm Burley's money, Loretta and Doolittle set out to promote her record. They headed down the West Coast in their old Mercury, stopping at every little radio station along the way. Not only were many of the DJs impressed with Loretta's record, but they couldn't help but be charmed by the naive, fresh-faced country girl.
I think that when Loretta became Loretta, the Loretta we know and love, the funny Loretta, the zany Loretta, the outgoing, the friendly Loretta, is when she begins to visit those radio stations and begins to crack people up with her mountainisms and her goofy, uneducated way of speaking.
I think once they got on the road with the record, they really became a team. I think Doo began respecting her more and more. I think he started to see what the world down the road would see, that everybody's going to love Loretta.
When they returned to Washington, they were told Honky Tonk Girl had hit number 14 on the Billboard chart. They had never heard of Billboard or charts, but they knew the next stop was Nashville. In August of 1960, Loretta and Doolittle dropped the kids off in Indiana with family and headed for Music City. Wearing a 99-cent Salvation Army dress, the tenacious young singer descended on Music Row and began hawking a record to anyone who would listen.
I mean, there wasn't a door at 8 o'clock in the morning that I didn't. Was sitting on the steps of the publishing companies.
I think that they just went moment by moment. You know, all of a sudden they made this little record. They got in this old car and drove to Tennessee to get on the Grand Ole Opry. That was the only thing that they saw. They had no plan. They had no money.
The good fortune and timing that began in Washington would continue when Loretta Lynn knocked on the door of Surefire Publishing. It was owned by the Wilburn Brothers, a successful country music act who were well connected in the Nashville entertainment industry. Doyle and Teddy Wilburn were immediately charmed.
I went in and said, I'm Loretta Lynn. I've got this little record out here. I'd like for you to listen to it.
I think what Teddy and Doyle saw in this woman was, first of all, her talent, her sincerity, the fact that she was believable. She was real.
She captured the heart, so to speak. And the first thing Doyle said was, Margie, we have met a female Hank Williams.
She was so naive, it was beautiful.
The Wilburns' first order of business was to get their new artist an appearance on the prestigious Grand Ole Opry. Doyle took Loretta to meet Ott Devine, the Opry manager. Devine was instantly taken with the delightfully unrefined newcomer. On October 15, 1960, just 3 months after she had arrived in Nashville, Loretta Lynn made her first appearance on the Grand Ole Opry. She was an immediate hit.
It put me on the Opry for 21 weekends in a row. And he said, well, today you're a Grand Ole Opry member. I jumped about that high off the floor, and they got that on a picture.
Playing the Opry and touring with the Wilburn Brothers show was earning Loretta a high profile in Music City. The next step for the Wilburns was to get Loretta signed to their record label, Decca Records. The man at the helm of Decca was Owen Bradley, the hottest producer in country music. Doyle was determined to get Loretta a record deal, whatever it took. Coming up, a distraught Loretta chooses career over family and leaves her newborn twins behind.
If I'd known what was going to happen, I wouldn't have started singing.
And later, the men she loved like brothers sue her for $5 million.
A 20-year contract is a lifetime contract, they call it. And I signed five of them in one day.
When CMT Inside Fame continues.
If you don't want to go to this city.
By 1962, under the watchful eye of Doyle and Teddy Wilburn, Loretta Lynn's career was gaining momentum. Now a member of the prestigious Grand Ole Opry, she was also learning her craft as the girl singer on the Wilburns' popular traveling show. The next step in Loretta's career was to land a record deal with noted producer and label head Owen Bradley at Decca Records. A determined Doyle took Bradley a tape of a new song sung by Loretta.
Doyle and I took that song in, and Doyle said, Chief, that's Doyle's personality. I want you to hear this song. This is a hit song.
And they played the tape for him. And Owen liked the song, and he wanted the song. But he didn't want the girl singer.
He said, I'm not here to push a song. I'm here to push the singer. He said, well, we've got a lot of girl singers, Doyle. I don't think we need to take another one.
And Doyle said, if you don't take the singer on the tape, you don't take the song. It was just that simple.
Finally, Owen said, okay, I'll tell you what I'll do. He said, I'll record Loretta Lynn if you will let me have that song for Brenda Lee. And Doyle said, all right, it's a deal. So out of that decision, Loretta Lynn got her Decca recording contract, and Brenda Lee got her first number one pop hit in a song called Fool Number One.
The biggest fool of all.
The effort that Doyle Wilburn went through to get her on Decca Records was definitely, I think, probably the most important move that was made in her behalf.
Owen Bradley took great care with his new artist. He was determined to capture Loretta's unique, plain-spoken appeal. It was important that she stand apart from his other female acts, particularly Kitty Wells, who had been a hero to Loretta since her early days in Washington.
It wasn't God who made
honky-tonk angel.
Bradley and others had noticed the similarity between Loretta and Kitty's vocal style.
Patsy Montana looked at me and said, "You'll never make it." And I said, "Why?" She said, "You sound like other girl singers I know," which was Kitty Wells. And I did. I patterned myself after Kitty Wells.
It's to his credit that he waited and held her until she had the right songs and had developed to the point that there would be no question she was not a Kitty Wells knockoff.
Owen Bradley's extra care paid off. By the end of the year, Loretta's first album had climbed to number one. The following year, 1964, she was named Billboard's top female vocalist. Loretta was also gaining national exposure on the Wilburn Brothers syndicated television show. The Wilburns were riding high with the hottest female property in town.
Whoa, whoa, you've hurt me enough today.
When you can be on the number two or three syndicated television show across the country for several years in a row, it'll either wipe you out or it'll help you. I think in Loretta's case, I think she's the first to say that it was a great help to her.
Just as her career was taking off, Loretta became pregnant with twins. It was not exactly welcome news. She was already feeling guilty for neglecting her four other children, and with her rising popularity, constant touring was an unavoidable reality. 9 days after the birth of the twins, Loretta and Doolittle were in Germany on a six-week tour. The two newborns were in Nashville with Doolittle's parents. Loretta could no longer deny she had made her choice, career over family.
That was the hardest tour, knowing my babies was back here. It's rough. There'd be times that I, you know, wished I'd never been on stage or never knew a song. But you gotta do one or the other. You can't do both at a time.
How many times did we hear Mom say every year, "Next year I'm gonna quit, I'm not gonna be working near as much, I'm gonna quit"?
Back then, if I'd known what was going to happen, I wouldn't have started singing, because my family means more to me than singing, and I love singing.
Although he was still Loretta's most trusted advisor, her husband Doolittle's role in the music business diminished greatly after she signed with the Wilburns. Once he returned from Germany, Doolittle rarely accompanied Loretta on tour. At the age of 37, Doolittle Lynn embraced fatherhood like never before.
When Mom got pregnant with Peggy and I, Dad completely changed. He didn't want to be out on the road. He wanted to stay at home. He wanted to work on the farm. He wanted to raise us.
After just 7 years in Nashville, Loretta's albums were selling at a rate unheard of for women in country music. The shy country girl who once was afraid to make eye contact with her audience was now in total command of the stage.
When a tingle becomes a chill.
She and Doolittle bought the remnants of a little town 60 miles southwest of Nashville called Hurricane Mills and transformed it into their ranch home. In Loretta's words, a hillbilly's dream. Almost overnight, Loretta and Doolittle had more money than they'd ever dreamed of, but there never seemed to be any time to enjoy it.
All of a sudden, she's successful. She has six children. She has a husband. She has a beautiful antebellum home on this, you know, 6,500-acre ranch. And she can't enjoy that. So she fantasizes about the life that she would have at home, you know, in her kitchen with her children.
With Doolittle at home on the ranch, the family was more stable than it had been in years. But with Loretta on the road, Doolittle was free to continue his ways with alcohol and women. Loretta... After signing with the Wilburn brothers, Loretta's enormous talents had blossomed, and her career had accelerated at a dizzying pace. By 1967, she was the Country Music Association's Female Vocalist of the Year. By the end of the decade, her popularity had surpassed all other female country singers.
I think what set her apart that she would do songs that were a little risque, you know, ones called Rated X or Wings Upon Your Horn, you know, things that, you know, a little bit different than just a straight-ahead girl country song.
But while Loretta's popularity was exploding, the Wilburn brothers were self-destructing. In the late 60s, Doyle's excessive drinking was causing problems within the organization. Teddy, who had worked most closely with Loretta, left the act and moved to California. Late in 1970, Loretta realized she was being woefully mismanaged. She found herself at an agonizing crossroad. These men that she loved like brothers had made her career, but now they were killing it. Loretta informed Doyle Wilburn she was leaving the agency. The Wilburns promptly sued her for $5 million.
The 20-year contract is a lifetime contract, they call it. And I signed five of them in one day. And I think three of them was with Doyle and Teddy.
Every woman in the history of country music who has gone out on her own has had to face a lawsuit. Look at Dolly Parton, Porter Wagoner. I mean, examples are numerous.
The lawsuit severed the relationship between the Wilburns and Loretta Lynn. The strong, almost familial bond that had grown up around the Wilburn brothers and the Lynns was a casualty of the litigation. No longer a side item in the Wilburn brothers' act, Loretta Lynn was now headlining her own tours. She was single-handedly bringing women out from under the shadow of the male superstars, proving that women were worthy of the same artistic and financial consideration as their male counterparts.
There are three women who profoundly changed what it meant to be a female country star in our time. Loretta, Tammy Wynette, and Dolly Parton. And Loretta was first.
By the end of the decade, she had won three National Songwriters Outstanding Achievement in Songwriting Awards. And throughout this whirlwind of activity, she was writing and singing about her own life with startling honesty.
This award ain't some doing means of fighting mad. You don't need no more of what you've already had. Your squaw is on the war path tonight.
She was, by and large, writing these songs that were not only changing the face of country music for women, but changing the face of country music.
Her fans were women and are women, and that's the way she likes it. That's who she's addressing. She's talking woman to woman, and that's really a breakthrough and really, really important.
Appealing to women as much as she did, it was no accident that Loretta teamed up with one of country music's best-known heartthrobs, former rock and roll star and teeny bopper icon, Conway Twitty. The collaboration charmed both critics and fans.
Make him believe I'll spend my lifetime.
The content of those duets was almost unfailingly sort of smoldering in lust kind of things, which, you know, that added a whole level of titillation to it, because she really was a Conway Twitty fan before she ever met him.
Mississippi man, we want it.
Loretta continued to win every award available to female country artists, but she remained a second-class citizen. Even though America was in the midst of a woman's movement, as women burned bras and took to the streets, demanding and receiving greater equality, the conservative country music establishment was slow to pick up on the trend. The highest honor in country music, the CMA Entertainer of the Year Award, was solely the dominion of men. No girl singer had ever won, and few females had ever even been nominated. In 1972, Loretta was again nominated, but held out little hope that she or any other woman could win.
Country Music Entertainer of the Year is Loretta Lynn.
It was kind of like a dream. It was kind of like something that wasn't happening, but it was.
She had no idea a woman could win that award.
There is a certain sisterhood, a kind of sisterhood among the female performers. And when Loretta Lynn became the first woman to win Entertainer of the Year, I think you probably heard shouts of applause from every pair of lips that had lipstick on it in this town.
Loretta continued to knock down doors with her accomplishments and her often strident songs about relationships. But the song that would ultimately define her was a simple, heartfelt tribute to her childhood. A song that would change her life.
Well, I was born a coal miner's daughter.
Miner's Daughter started a chain of events that would radically alter the public's perception of country music. After the success of the song, Loretta set out, with the help of journalist George Vesey, to write an autobiography that described her journey from Butcher Holler to Nashville.
Her life story was so compelling that the book makes it onto the New York Times bestseller lists. That lifts her in the public consciousness. She starts doing the Johnny Carson show, and everybody gets to see what we had already seen, which is this very funny, very neat lady, very feisty, very funny gal.
It didn't take Hollywood long to cash in on the phenomenon. Just 4 years after the book, Coal Miner's Daughter was an Oscar-winning movie.
But when Coal Miner's Daughter came out, my mother's success went from here to way
Universal.
It was amazing.
I think the movie just really, took Loretta into another plane.
I've been there, especially after the movie came out, where women have walked up to my dad and just wanted to slap him in the face. How could you do that to such a lovely woman? How do you act like that? And all of this, and Dad's like, yeah, it's a movie.
But Coal Miner's Daughter was more than just a movie. It transformed Loretta into a national figure. She was in constant demand, a frequent guest on the most popular talk shows of the day. She recorded at least 2 albums a year and began touring relentlessly, expanding the popularity of country music throughout the world.
A rising tide lifts all boats, and it was because of the success of Coal Miner's Daughter that country music really does take a leap forward in the public consciousness.
The funny thing is, in her words, the movie ended and it looked as if she had ridden off into the sunset with Do, and of course that's not what happened.
The rosy scenario painted at the end of the movie was indeed not what happened. Although her career was wildly successful, Loretta Lynn was entering one of the most trying periods of her personal life. The lawsuit that had begun in 1971 with the Wilburns finally came to trial. A broken-hearted Loretta was forced to take the stand against the people she loved. Through her tears, she recalled numerous incidents of Doyle's humiliating drunkenness while working on her behalf. When it was over, the shaken and weary Loretta Lynn had won her freedom. But for the Wilburns and others, the wounds would never heal. Doyle took it particularly hard.
Never have I seen a broken man. He was crying. It hurt him because he loved her so much. And the whole family loved her. Mom Wilburn, she loved her just as much as Doyle and Teddy did. He never believed that it would go down and happen like that.
Regardless of what transpired, it was a sad thing for friends to not still be friends.
It just ended in a wrong way. It had to go to court, and I don't think it needed to. I think it could have worked out.
Loretta's most difficult trial, however, began in 1984, when her son, Jack, drowned while crossing a swollen river on horseback. He was the oldest son, the spitting image of his father, and in many ways, the child that Loretta felt most sentimental about. Jack Benny Lynn was 33 years old. The loss changed both Loretta and Doolittle forever.
When they pulled my brother's body out of that river, somewhere on that creek bank, we lost a great deal of my dad. He was never the same.
No, there was a big change.
Our family was never the same.
Everybody says, well, the horse kicked him. And I don't go for that. Never will.
What do you think?
I think somebody hit him and threw him in the water.
Loretta definitely hasn't gotten over losing Jack. And I don't think anybody gets over losing their children in any way.
With the lawsuit and the death of her son, Jack, Loretta Lynn had endured a devastating 4 years. But they would not compare to the pain of what was to come.
And love is a foundation we lean on.
Coming up, the battle that had raged for 40 years comes to a quiet end.
And finally, I looked down at him and said, honey, you just go around the corner and I'll be okay.
When CMT Inside Fame continues.
So get out while you can, 'cause you ain't woman enough to take my man.
In the early 80s, the phenomenal success of the movie Coal Miner's Daughter had brought Loretta Lynn to the height of her career. But her unrivaled worldwide success was soon tempered by family tragedy. She lost her mother to lung cancer, and her hard-driving road schedule had pushed her to the point of exhaustion. But it was the devastating loss of her oldest son, Jack, that sent her into an emotional tailspin. Loretta was just beginning to be able to face her career again when her husband, Doolittle Lynn, was diagnosed with diabetes. After a lifetime of alcohol abuse, his body was finally giving out.
When Doo got sick, there was no question for Loretta. Her career was completely on hold. It was as if she'd never had the career.
What we came to find out is Mom had this strength that started coming up. As the sicker Dad got, the stronger Mom got.
Loretta spent her days and nights on a sofa next to Doolittle's bed, sleeping only when he slept, tending to his every need.
She fed him. She made sure that he had his medicine. She bathed him. She did everything for him. And my mother's a little bitty person.
In 1995, a frail Doolittle joined Loretta on her weekly show, Loretta and Friends, where she sang one of his favorite songs to him.
And love is a foundation we lean on. All you need is love to ease your mind. Oh, and does it have to be right to be caught?
Don't cry. Through all the turmoil that Loretta and Doolittle had through the whole life, they loved each other.
I think that Doo and me was probably one of the hardest and the best love story that's ever been told. It was a hard love story, but we did love each other.
In August of 96, after 47 years of fussing, fighting, laughing, and loving, Doolittle Lynn died in the arms of his adoring wife.
Finally, I looked down at him and said, honey, you just go around the corner and I'll be okay. I said, it won't be long, I'll meet you. And he took one breath and died. That was so hard. It was so hard.
After Doolittle died, Loretta moved to another house in Nashville to grieve. It was a year before she could face Hurricane Mills and its many memories of Doolittle. The 90s were an emotionally taxing decade. Besides Doolittle, Loretta also lost her brother, Jay Lee, her longtime producer, Owen Bradley, her girlfriend, Tammy Wynette, and her dear friend and duet partner, Conway Twitty. The year after Doolittle's death, Loretta slowly began to pick up the pieces of her career, taking an occasional job every few months. In 1998, she recorded her first solo album in 12 years. After all those years away from the music scene, Loretta's first single off the album, Country in My Jeans, made it onto the charts.
Lord, I've got country in my jeans. Lord, I've got country in my jeans.
I thought it was so cool in 2000 when Loretta Lynn placed a single on the country popularity charts at age 65. I mean, women are thrown on the scrap heap by this industry when they're 40, and there she was, still in there, duking it out with the kids. I thought it was just the coolest.
Loretta Lynn's legendary status stems as much from her life as from her art. But when the two combine, something rare and beautiful happens that is uniquely Loretta and uniquely American.
I think that's why people have embraced her the way they have over the years, because she's not afraid to be who she is.
Still sings her butt off, and, you know, she's just a natural talent. You know, she's just down home earth.
Loretta has something that I wish we had more of this day and time. When you hear her voice, she's such a stylist, there is no doubt. That's Loretta.
She has an extraordinary instrument, much better than people know. And she's in the Country Music Hall of Fame, and by God, she deserves to be in there.
In spite of her Hall of Fame status, her friends and fans will tell you she's still very much the funny, feisty little girl from Butcher Holler.
I hope I never say anything to hurt nobody. That's how I'd like to be remembered, as just a good person. That's it.
Wouldn't it be fine if you could say you love me just one time with a sober mind? Wouldn't that be fine? Now wouldn't that be fine? Wouldn't it be great if you could love me first and let the bottle wait? Wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't it be great? Hey, yes, wouldn't that be great? Throw the old glass crutch away and watch it break.